Pak Hassan, why does movie or film mesmerizes you? When do you start liking movies? And what makes you attracted to it? Is it because of the storytelling part?
Well, I think the first time that I began to look at film seriously was after I had sat for my HSC, Higher School Certificate, in 1974, I think, or 73. And I began to seriously go into English literature. So even though I used to get distinction in English in almost every exam, it was only when I took the higher school certificate that I began to know what literature was really about. Then I happened to read a film review and I saw the similarities. We were talking about character, about story, about plot, and so on. So because of my strong background in literature, I began to react to that. And I began to look at films differently. And at the same time, I was already into still photography, and I like to take all these backlighted shots, which is actually going against the rules, but you get better pictures. And it all clicked. And then, because I was working in a film studio, but I was a titling artist, and then I got into animation. And I think at the very early stage, I already discovered that animation's foundation is actually film. And of course, nobody listened to me. And I began to be a bit more serious. And I used to see about 300 films a year in the cinemas. And I used to take notes in the dark, some of which I could not read after that.
Yeah.
But I was already interested in film or watching films in primary school. But I remember in my town, of the small town of Julutong in Penang, there was a Chinese guy who had a 16mm projector. This was, I think, 1955 or 56. And he used to screen all these Tarzan films, cowboy movies, and so on, from his veranda onto a wall of a shop house on the other side. And people used to congregate there. And I never missed it. Later, I heard that he was shot by the communists. I don't know why until today. And then sometime in 1960s, 61, 62, I found a strip of 35mm film from a Hindustan movie. And it was on the Sandy Road next to my house. Now, the nearest cinema was about, I think about 6 to 7 miles away. I cannot imagine and I cannot figure out how a strip of film could be on the sandy road.
Yeah. Fake calling pursuit.
So maybe it's a premonition. Who knows, huh? And I couldn't figure out why the frames were all similar. And then when I was in primary school, English school, Westlands in Penang, there was a projector in the school, 16mm, and they used to screen this film. So you had to buy the tickets. It was about 30 cents to see films. And I was a guy who would sit at the lights, switch it on and off. I just loved doing that. And I saw Laurel and Hardy, Chaplin movies, films from England, from Hollywood, and so on. So I was keen on films, but not seriously wanting to go into film, because you know, we were never thinking along those lines. And then I think because I was also good in art, even though I know I didn't have talent, but I was able to draw not very well. And my art teacher, Mr. Chong Won Kwan, he saw my interest and he knew I was from a very poor family, couldn't afford to buy paint and so on. He gave them to me and even guided me. So I mentioned him in my book specifically on animation history, which will be out soon. And then from 1974, we had a film club, which was started by Datuk Syed Alwi, who is from Perak. He was famous for his story Tok Perak, which he wrote and then made it into a TV drama and staged many times. So I was working with him, doing graphics, diagrams for his documentary film on Kuala Lumpur. So he told me that he was starting the film club. He said, why don't you come and join? So I went. And of course, I was hooked because these are films that you will never get to see. And I remember in 1979 going to London specifically to see all these films that we never get a chance to see because they were all alternative films. And of course, after seeing those films, I started to read up on these classic movies which are studied in film schools. And which means I am now going deeper into literature through film. And later I began to go into reading academic books. I became more serious. And that's how it all began for me. And then I became a film director. Began to write seriously, understanding of screenplays and so on. And I directed Malaysia's first animated feature film. It was 1998. Made a lot of public service advertisements. Was involved in TV commercials for Malaysia, for London, for many countries around the world.
But when you do the animation advertisements, are you doing it on your own or actually attached with established advertising companies?
Well, 1978 was my first commercial, which I did for Ogilvy and Mather. Oh. And Farida Marikan from Penang was the producer. And I had never done TV commercials before. And actually, I was thrown into the deep end of the pool because it was a very difficult one where you have live action together with the animation. And when you do that, you don't move the camera. But the director had moved the camera. So I had to figure out now, how am I going to match these two things? Yeah. And I was sitting there silently during the meeting, and everybody turned and looked at me and asked me, can you do it? So I just crossed my fingers and said, no problem. And it happened, and I'm still having that clip. The first one that I did where the man is talking to the cartoon character on the billiard table, the camera moves from him. So I traced the position of the table frame by frame. So it was about a 3 second move. So I had to trace the table 72 times. So as to match the movement of the animation.
Yeah.
So it was highly technical because no computers around at that time. Today, you close your eyes, you get it done. So I worked with people who were really very much better than I was. So therefore, I learned a lot of things. And that's what I always tell my students. Be around people who are better than you are. Then only you are going to go up. So I think all that helped me in my career later when I became a film director. And so from there, 1982, I established a company. And it was the first animation studio in Malaysia. And I did a lot of commercials for about 18 years. And I worked with all the top directors and production houses and also art agencies. Until my last one was Sugus, the Six Fruits Dancing on Stage. That was my biggest project. It was done originally for Indonesia. And it's not 3D, it's 2D, but painted like 3D. And then it was the only commercial that played for 5 years. And then Malaysia wanted it also. So I was paid for doing nothing for the copyright. So they used it for Malaysia, then I did for Taiwan, Thailand and Hong Kong. Okay. So that was the last. I said, enough, no more.
Oh, so you stopped because of your own will?
Yeah, yeah. Because I get a call at 3 o'clock in the morning. We are now ready to go online. So I said, okay, this is the last. I'm not going to wake up at 3 in the morning anymore.
Okay, interesting. Okay, is there any events in your life that shape you to determine what you want to do?
Not really, but I can mention something very strange that happened to me. I made this film called Sangkanjil dan Monyet, the mouse deer and the monkey, which was the biggest hit. It was 5 minutes long. It took 9 months to complete, all hand-drawn. But I must go back a little bit. 10 years earlier, I was still working in the studio as a titling artist, not yet directing. And you know, my pay was very low. So I used to try and save money. So the bus fare was 5 cents. from Kampung Baru to Kuala Lumpur. So to avoid paying that, I walked. And I was walking behind these buildings in the small road, which was very dark. And then I heard a voice. "Sir, I have not eaten for 4 days." I turned, there was an Indian man wearing the typical Indian dhoti. And I said, "Oh my God, he hasn't eaten for 4 days." So I took out 1 ringgit and gave it to him, forgetting that I was trying to save 5 cents. So I went to KL because there was a push cart selling teh tarik for 10 cents, cake for 10 cents. So that was my dinner. 2 nights later, I was walking along the same road and again I heard the voice. "Sir, I have not eaten for 4 days." I turned and he recognized me from 2 nights ago. So he was like very embarrassed. And but I wasn't upset. I took 40 cents and gave it to him and walked on. And I heard him calling again, "Sir." So I thought he wanted more money. I turned to look at him and he had his hands like this, like making a supplication to God, I think, for me. And I never saw him after that. Now, 10 years later, I was now promoted to be the head of my unit in Film Negara. And there was a new minister and a new director general. They saw the first animation film called The Tale of the Mouse Deer, Hikayat Sang Kancil, which took 11 years to make by one man. And he was not even an animator, but because he could animate a little, so they asked him to do it during his free time when he was not doing set design, which was his official job. And they said, "Wow, this is great. Go ahead and make 13 episodes of the Mouse Deer series," without asking me whether we knew how to do it, whether we had the equipment and so on. So I couldn't turn around and tell him because I was just promoted, isn't it? So again, I was thrown into the deep end of the pool, okay? And if I had not done it, the animation industry would probably have taken another 20 years to start. So I said, "Well, I'm going to get staff together and we'll see what we can do." And I wrote the script, I did the storyboard, I directed, I did some of the animation, I also did some of the backgrounds and so on, because I knew about all of this because I had been doing commercials. So now you see how that helped me in what I was going to do. And I was also doing administration, and I had my right-hand man who thought he should have been promoted to be the head, and he was creating all kinds of problems for me. Now, this film became a huge hit when it came out. Why? As compared to the earlier movie, which was very straightforward, mine had humor. So if you're using animation, you should have humor or something that cannot be done through the live action. Sure. And I had this dialogue, "I have not eaten for 4 days," coming from the monkey in the story, which was cheating the mouse deer, which was working very hard, and he just wanted free food. Now, I never remembered that dialogue from that Indian man.
Yeah.
Until 20 years later.
And you are doing this.
My friend, a former student of mine, who was now working, he came to interview me, and he asked exactly your question. "Did something happen in your life that you put into this film?" And then I remembered that incident. Actually, when I was born, they cast a horoscope and they said that I will reach a very high level in the spiritual area as well as doing all this kind of thing.
Your work, your career.
And even the famous palmist who saw my palm, he said, "You will do something that will be seen by the nation and give you great respect." So you see, palmistry is not hokam.
Tolong, tolong. Dah 4 hari aku tak makan.
Yeah, okay. We quickly talk about the animation industry, since you mentioned your earlier career involved in that. We understand that you have now stopped your animation when you start to call it a day. But looking at currently, come back to the current situation now, with all the high technology that's involved in the animation industry and getting more people involved, more talents here. Where do you see the animation industry in Malaysia going to be? Do you think that it has a bright future, or you probably think that we should just let the other guys who has more knowledge and experience in the outside world to do it, and then we'll focus back onto the movie making and the film industry?
until 1994, we didn't have an industry. So we in Film Negara had the only animation camera and equipment and expertise to do animation, and that's why we did. And in the 70s, these films were very popular because I did all these public service advertisements where I used humor for serious subjects. Like the Nyamo Aedes, where the Nyamo talking, that film was banned because they said in parliament that why is the head of the mosquitoes talking like the opposition party leader? Can you imagine? So the 70s, my studio was known for animation and not for documentaries. So that's where when the private sector saw what I had done, they called me to do commercials. Now, all these films, including the Sang Kanjil series, actually influenced many cartoonists to get into animation. And I was also involved in 1994 when RTM received two requests. Somebody had done a short clip of animation and they said, can you give us a commission us to do animation series? Because there were no animation series at that time. And I was one of the people who was called in as an expert to look at the two and comment. And that's where the animation industry started. So in 1995, the first television series was on air, which is Usop Sontorian, followed by Sangwira. And when I went on optional retirement in 1995, I was working on the first episode. Oh. So in a sense, I was there from the very beginning. So I think that's why, I was given the award by the Prime Minister as the father of Malaysian animation.
Yeah, animation.
Give me the money. Well, actually, he did give me a check for 10,000. From 1995 until now, we now have, I think, easily about 500 television series made locally. This is a big record in the ASEAN region, where if you take Thailand, Philippines, Singapore, Indonesia, and so on, they don't have their own ongoing television series. And we also have made 13 feature films, animation feature films, as compared to all the other countries that have mostly, I think on average, they have about 5. So it was through very strong government support right from the very beginning to kickstart the animation industry. And until today, the government is giving a lot of support through the, after setting up the multimedia super corridor, because when Dr. Mahathir took over in 1981, he saw how digital technology was going to transform the way we work, the way we play, the way we think, and so on. So he could already see it, and he set up asked to set up the multimedia university. And as you know, some of the graduates have done Geng Pengembaraan Bermula, the first 3D for cinema. And then Upin dan Ipin, this is a huge success, crossed boundaries, went to other countries,
Indonesia,
and he has become an icon. And Boy, the next one, by the same group of people. So you can see that what he did actually moved the industry and transformed the way we were doing animation. So right up to about 1980s, when the software came in, I was the first in Malaysia to use the 2D software for animation. And I did that for a commercial. Before I did the commercial, I did one for Shell, where we had the Shell character animated, lip syncing, and that was first use of software. And then I did Pak Hassan Ria and Pak Hassan Grand, where we had Wile E. Coyote, Roadrunner, and Daffy Duck. So I had the opportunity to animate this, and I still have the clips if you like to put it on. And so I was the earliest, and I was the first animator in Malaysia to be trained on a 3D software in Singapore. It was 1987. And I was working on the Amiga, and I did the first animation using PC with half a megabyte, and it came out on television. And I have all this, not a sample, but the still photographs of all of this. So right from the very beginning, I was already into the changes that were taking place. And it's very fortunate because now when I have written the book, I can explain all this history. It's all there. And then today, many of my students who I've trained in Lim Kok Wing, One Academy, Multimedia University, and many other colleges, they are all now top in the industry because the way I taught animation was emphasizing the aspects of storytelling. Because Disney had three philosophies, and it doesn't mention technology, doesn't mention animation. Number one, he said, create great characters with distinct personalities. Number two, give them great stories to act out. And number three, the next film must be better than the last one. So as you can see, the latest Jungle Book, which is a live-action boy with a completely 3D and in a completely 3D environment, and you see how far they have come because of the technology. So today, we have people who are really good at using the 3D software, and then using Flash animation and a lot of other software that has come, including like using After Effects and so on. So we are now being commissioned by Cartoon Network, Nickelodeon, Nelvana, and many other big studios in the world, because our expertise has reached such a high level that we can deliver. And it's good that we are on this side of the hemisphere. So while when it is daytime here, it's nighttime there when they are sleeping. So we are working while they are sleeping, and the next day we can deliver when they are awake. So technology has changed totally the way we work, and it has become a big boost and a boon to people who understand how to make use of it. So we are actually very far ahead as compared to many other countries.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
So you should read my book.
Yes, we are waiting for that. We'll talk about the book later. It's a new project. You also, you know, during your series of your discourse and interview, also public talks, you always mentioned that about the local audience not knowing the proper language in the movie or film. But then, you know, in our defense, the fact remains that most of us are not exposed to this. So how do you think this gap can be bridged between the industry and the audience and the public, so that, you know, the audience can actually better appreciate what is being shown, you know, in a screen?
We should look to the West for the answer. In the West at one time, they were studying Norse legends, the legends of ancient Rome, ancient Greece, and so on. Why was that important? Because the basis of storytelling is all there, like Greek tragedy. Look at Shakespeare's stories. You can see almost every story in the world, more or less, is being reflected, was reflected in Shakespeare's stories. And of course, like Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales, Beowulf. So all these are very important to read. And this was the culture for the Western people, particularly in Europe, that they were very deep into all of these things, right from the medieval days. And German Expressionism, I don't know if you know German Expressionism, is a movement in literature and art. And in Russia, when film first came, they were more into the theories of montage, which is about editing. That storytelling in film is nothing but editing, a sequence of shots where at the end you get the meaning. But then in the 1940s, the French came out, André Bazin, he said, no, film is not editing. Film is mise-en-scène, which means in one long take where the camera, you do not cut. In one long take, the meaning is within that scene. Today, we are using both. Okay? Then, if you look at the literature from Europe, many of the fables, the fairy tales and so on that Disney is using comes from there. Grimm's fairy tales and so many others that I cannot remember. I read all this when I was in primary school and secondary school. So you can see that all these stories are actually teaching stories, like Aesop's fables.
Yeah.
And I animated a few, like The Clever Crow and so on, five that I did based on this. And then in India, you have the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and the Jataka tales, and the Panchatantra, where animal stories, they are all teaching stories. Now, Aristotle, 2500 years ago, he said, stories are all about how men should live their lives. And if you look at Plato's, about the cave, I think, he mentioned about the cave, that when people are living in this cave, they see shadows, and they think the shadows are actually reality, But then only they will realize that the shadows are cast by something else. So this got carried forward into shadow play, wayang kulit, that the puppeteer is in effect God and the shadows are men. So all this, God has, is actually showing these things to us so that we can see ourselves in those characters and so on. A very famous Indonesian director called Teguh Karya, was a friend of mine. I asked him, what is film to you? He said, I put you on the screen. If you can see yourself among the characters, I have succeeded. And Andre Bazin in the 1940s, he said more or less the same thing. The cinema screen is like a window where you look upon the lives upon others that reflect your own lives. Now, to your question, how can the audience understand what the filmmaker is saying? In the year 1912, a group of people in Germany called the Gestalt psychologists, they got together. They were psychologists, artists, and other people, I think. They investigated how is it that when an audience is confronted with a work of art, how can they grasp the meaning intended by the artist? Then they discovered many, many principles that were similar in almost all the artists and all around the world. Then other people like Claude Levi-Strauss, who came out with the theory of binary opposition, Carl Jung, who came out with the theory of archetypes, and then Charles Peirce about semiotics, Ferdinand Saussure about signs, signifier, and signified. It all comes together. But unfortunately, this is not being taught in schools and colleges and universities. I am the only one teaching this in Malaysia and in Singapore and in Sudan and in Norway. They never connected this. Now, Leonardo da Vinci, 500 years ago, he said that everything is linked to everything else. But you have to find that link. So I think I discovered that link where disparate subjects are actually linked together, and they are 100% used in visual storytelling and sound. But people thought it was only in anthropology, in psychology, in literature, and so on. So I brought all that, and I mentioned in one chapter on the right training in my book for animation, and I described this in a very basic form. So you see, what is lacking in our educational system that can bring our audience, create an audience that can appreciate art, is lacking. So we have to go back to the old European way of teaching the arts in education, whether you are learning engineering or accountancy or whatever, there must be this, because today, because of digital technology, which is about right brain and left brain working together, you have to bring that in. Then we can create a better audience for the artworks of students who are now into, I have chosen art as their career, which in the 50s or 60s they said, hey, can you eat if you take up art and so on, and make that your career.
So I can see coming, continue with that questions. You know, we talk about the audience, you know, there's a clearly lack of understanding. And then now we go to one step higher up, which is basically the authority. You know, the relevant authorities trying to, even though they are trying to promote the film industry and in the animation industry in the country, but then, you know, there's still a lot of shortcomings that we have to, you know, try to overcome. And I understand that you have been talking about this for many, many years, and still the situation does not really improve. And correct me if I'm wrong here. So this question is a bit personal to you, is do you get tired of doing this? Do you think that you still want to continue doing it, ranting about it, and then trying to tell them what to do, even though they are listening to you, but they are not doing anything, maybe for reasons of their own that, you know, beyond their control?
Well, if you start, if you stop talking about it, that means it's time to die. Okay, so in art, we never give up, because art flourishes in conflict. So when there is conflict, you can see great art coming out. And that's why you can see after the war, we saw classic movies that have been made in Japan, in the neorealism in Italy and so on, great works come out which we are studying until today. And during the war too in Hollywood, film noir was about that conflict within themselves. So they created all these characters who are in the shadows and you cannot trust the good guy, even the good guy. So this also happened in Singapore when he was part of Malaya in the 50s. So we saw P. Ramlee's works which we are studying now in great detail about this conflict in society at that time. So P. Ramlee said, do not depend on the Malays that have succeeded, that are rich, because they are not helping for the other Malays to come up. That was his theme that was running through his entire movie. Now, we cannot depend on the politicians, because the politicians are only interested in their image. So they say the artwork must make money. Okay, if you are making movies, it must make money. So if you put money first, it's not art. Money must come second. So a good work of art, like a good film, has got three criteria. Number one, it must entertain.
Yeah.
Number two, it has something to say. So a true artist has something to say when he came up with this particular story. He's hiding something. And then number three, it must reflect the culture of a people. So culture is not about dress. It's not about language. So the recent fiasco about the film festival, they have to leave language out of the picture. As an example, if you have a Chinese or an Indian making a film about Chinese and Indians only, and there is absolutely no dialogue, now which category is it going to be put under for the awards? Under the Bahasa Malaysia or non-Bahasa Malaysia? So you see the problem? So I've already written to the Director General of FINAS and given him a couple of ideas to have an academic conference. So these are the things that we have to look at, and we have to keep on talking about it. Now, I've been talking about animation from the 1970s. When I first got into animation, I began to think that you must teach animation in the school, because animation makes use of everything that you're learning, whether it's mathematics, whether it's English, or whatever, it all comes into play. Because there are also calculations involved, you know, for shooting and so on, which of course the students today do not know. So I already saw it, but of course nobody was listening because I was not known. But today, because now I think I have become famous, I think, they are now paying attention. So I'm being called by universities, and I've been also involved in curriculum development. And I'm also on the MQA panel examinations and on juries and so on. So that's where I keep on talking about this. So I think we need to keep on reminding people. So you cannot depend on the politicians because their terms are very short. And if it doesn't make money, they are going to be criticized. So that's the problem that we are having. They're not interested in culture or whatever.
Now we just go back to the Malaysian film industry. Now, you know that the authorities have their own mindset in trying to terms what is a Malaysian movie. Yeah? And I think they have been debating for quite some time and still haven't come to a conclusion. Now, if being the industry player, shouldn't they also play a role here in trying to convince or work or collaborate with the authorities in trying to define what a Malaysian movie should be, rather than, you know, being racially segregated, you know, and never come to a conclusion, and this debate will continue on and on, and it will never end.
So in the constitution, it says that Bahasa Malaysia is the language, the official language of the country. Yeah. You can't argue with that,
yeah,
unless you go to parliament and make the change, which probably will never happen. And I think we should maintain it, because even Singapore, its national anthem is in Malay.
Yes.
Okay? So therefore, when their film goes to Academy Award nominations, it has to be a film in the Malay language. But now I think it's changed. From 2006, the Oscars have taken that out. So it's a problem because of the diaspora. So in my letter to the Director General about 2 days ago, I said we need to discuss with academics and the industry, number one, what is cinema? And I can tell you they are going to run into problems, because nobody can define what is cinema. even the great Akira Kurosawa, the Japanese director, at the age of 75, he said, "I am only now beginning to understand what film is all about." And I think I was past the age of 60 because of my mentor, Dr. Anwar Mu'arif, I began to really understand what film is about. And I can say it's about form. Form is a big subject, but I can make it simple. If you see someone walking towards you from a distance, you do not know who the person is, Chinese, Malay, Indian, German, but you can say that, this person is tall and thin, or short and fat, or maybe the person has got a limb, so he must have some problem with his leg and so on. That is quite clear to you. So a film is more or less like that. After you see the film, you either hate the film, or you like the film, or you say, well, I like it, but you know, I have some problem with it. You are talking about its form, without going to the details as to what actually is it that you like about and what it is that you hate about, right? Now, as the person comes nearer and nearer to you, then you begin to see, it's a Malay guy, and he's wearing so-and-so shirt, and then he's got a pen in his pocket. The details come out. And then you can come to a better conclusion as to whether is a good guy or a bad guy. Now, here's something very strange, which is in film, but it's also in real life. Where does this come from? I'm not at liberty to say, but I can give you a little bit of tips. Carl Jung's theory of archetypes. It's about people, events, rituals, and whatever that gets repeated from ancient days until today. For instance, at a university convocation, everybody is dressed in the what I call the circus costume, the long robes and so on, which were actually influenced from the Al-Azhar University in Egypt. That's where it came from, 1,000 years ago. So they are very formal. They have this guy carrying the mace, and then they are all, you know, very serious looking, and then there's this announcement, and then people come to Ne, they tip their hat and so on. It's actually recreating something like what happened in the ancient days when you go to see a king. That's how it has to be, isn't it? Very formal and so on, because there's a lot of ceremony, tradition, whatever attached to it. Why do we need to do that? Why can't you just have the guy, hey, Vice Chancellor, how are you? And then shake his hand and take the thing. Why don't we do that? So there's a reason for it. It's to maintain the sanctity, that the thing that you are going to receive is something that's very important, that's going to determine what you are going to be, isn't it? But it's not spoken, it's not written. You just understand it. But do people ever think about that, including the Vice Chancellor who is giving all that? Does he understand this? It's only when you understand that you become a better storyteller, right? And that's why there are certain films which are so powerful, is because it's very strong with these undercurrents. So he talked about archetypes. Now, why is it that when a character appears in the film, you can say, hey, this is the hero. And when this guy comes, this is the bad guy. What is it? We usually identify Hollywood that the guy who is with slit eyes is the bad guy. So they chose Koreans, Japanese and Chinese as the bad guys in their films. Today is the guy with a beard and mustache and wearing a turban. So you see, where did this come from? Now in real life, there are people that you meet, you like, or you don't like at first sight. Why? Where does this come from? So, because I'm a Muslim, I cannot tell you because it will be a problem. Okay? Because I have gone beyond the normal orthodox religion to discover all these things. So that is what has helped me in talking about film and art in general and also literature, that I can go deeper into the subject. And this is what great artists have, that whenever they write or do an artwork, they are talking about something that's very, very deep. For instance, in the Daffodils, the poem written by Wordsworth, he said that inward eye, which is the bliss of solitude. you have to have that inward eye. And in Buddhism, they say you must open the third eye. They say it's here. Actually, it's not here. It's not physical. It's the enlightened mind that makes you see what other people do not see. But to reach that level, you cannot be ordinary. But you see, be ordinary, but have this extraordinary mind. That's how you can create great works.
Okay. Now let's come back to a bit on the more on your personal work side. Once you finish the first book, Malaysia Cinema the Bottle, back in 2013. So do you have any special feeling once you have written that book and get it published?
I had been wanting to write a book on Malaysian cinema for a long time, but I never got around to it. So sometime in 2011, I think, this guy came from France, in France, Lyon. He was the director of the Lyon Film Festival. So he came and went all over Asia to write a book on Asian cinema. So he came to see me and asked me to write 25,000 character essay. Now, I thought it was 25,000 words. Character means the letter, isn't
okay.
it? So I had this long essay on Malaysian cinema. And of course, I had to cut it down for him. Then end of 2012, I think, or 13, I can't remember. A friend of mine is a poet. He said, why don't you put all your articles together and publish it as a book? And coincidentally, a publisher who is also a theatre activist, he said, there's going to be a writer's festival. Can you write a book on Malaysian cinema? And then I said, okay, I'll take this long essay, I'll add things to it with all the information I've compiled over 20 years. And I did it quickly, so there are a couple of typos here and there. I didn't have an editor. So it came out, and of course I wrote from a personal point of view because I was involved. And I worked with some of the pioneers from the 1950s. And I remembered all those that dialogue that I had with them. And quite a lot is totally new information. And I also did research, and very early cinema, I had actually written an article for a book called Early Asian Cinema, where my friend from the Philippines, Nick Diocampo, was the editor. So he got some of the famous writers like Stephen Bottomore, Vimala Disanayake. These were scholars. So here I am together with scholars. So I decided to research, and then I discovered a lot of things. And it's a good thing that he actually asked me to do that, because that became part of my opening. And today, I'm being called a scholar by scholars from all over the world. Can you imagine that?
Indeed, a very good achievement. Now, after this first book, now you just finished your second book, which is going to be published within a month's time, I understand. And this is about animation. So is there going to be any other upcoming projects that you have in mind?
Yeah.
After movies, then animation, then what else?
My third book was actually the first I was working on. It's about the history of the Malayan Film Unit. The film unit set up by the British in 1946, which is where animation also began. And because I had been working with some of those people, and I was working in Film Negara, which is Malayan Film Unit, the old name, I'd worked with the pioneers, and I knew one or two of the early, the European from England, who had been training our people. And I compiled all this information, and I have all these original photos from the 1940s and 1950s, which will be seen for the first time. But I had actually written two articles before on the Malayan Film Unit, the only ones I ever written. And one was published in an academic journal in London by the Royal Asiatic Society. The second one was published by the British Film Institute because they had a conference on early the British Empire and the setting up of units in the Commonwealth. And those two are being referred by scholars all over the world. And in the British Film Institute website called colonialfilms.org, the guy who did all the writing, Dr. Tom Rice, he referred to my papers. And that's a book that will be out hopefully by next year. But I think it will be a little academic. I know the early history about how it started, how the Crown Film Unit came to cover the retreat of the Japanese, but then the bomb exploded, so there was no invasion. And a lot of interesting things. And one of them, one of the locals who was working with the Crown Film Unit as a driver, ultimately retired as a director general of the film negara.
Oh, okay.
So these are very interesting things that are going to be in my book.
Knowing you as a storyteller, Pak Hassan, I'm sure this book is going to be very interesting to read. Not so much of academic.
It has to be interesting also to a certain extent. Because my target has always been the general audience.
Yeah.
But at the same time, the scholars also would benefit from it.
Yeah. And also we noticed, you know, Pak Hassan, since you have been involved in the art scene for so long, and occasionally you have been showing some of your artworks, whether it is a painting, you know, your some of your early animation works, and also some photographs, you know, that you put on your social network. Do you have any concrete plans to do something about those works, you know, to show to the public, you know, your thoughts, your ideas, you know?
Well,
over
think,
time, how you transform.
Okay. I've done given a couple of interviews, but nothing that goes on air. There have been ideas to make a documentary about myself, because I was one of the pioneers in animation. But I think what you are doing right now is also towards that, and I hope you can do something about it. Not because it's about me, but it's about my involvement, and it's related to the arts in Malaysia. When I was in school, my art wasn't good. So I still have my record book where my art teacher wrote, next year don't take art. So I tell my students, don't listen to what your teacher says about you. You are not a failure unless you think you are a failure. So I failed my Form 5 secondary school examinations. I failed my Form 3 also. So I sat twice, but for Form 5, I learned on my own. But I've always been keen on learning new things. I'm one of the people who didn't want to listen to teachers talking because it's boring. Oh, but I remember in primary school there was a Chinese teacher who I loved to come to his class because he told us stories about the monkey god. That was so interesting to me. And I think all that helped later. So my late mother used to see me drawing instead of reading books. And she said, famous last words, do you think this is going to give you your food? So today, I can say that I was paid sometimes more than even the PhDs. In Sudan, I was paid 28,000 ringgit for that 1 month workshop that I did on directing documentaries. Mm. So I was copying artworks. That's how I learned art. And I was copying the masters. If you are copying the masters, you are in fact learning from them, how can you go wrong? And even in animation, I was copying the animation of the famous guys from National Film Board of Canada, even Disney. So how could I not come to a certain level, isn't it? So I was not learning from a teacher who was probably doing it, you know, with his own opinions and so on. I was going right down to the core. So that's how I picked up the classical as well as the independent approach. So then my art reached a level, I mean, if you look at my artwork, you will not believe that I did not have talent and I did not study art. So the One Academy is famous for its illustrations and its artwork. They took my artwork to publicize because I was one of the lecturers there. So now my artwork is all over the world. And in the 80s, I only did line drawings of old Malay houses, which is now a historical record. All those houses are no more.
Yeah.
And many students and those who are doing PhDs and masters do interview me for their thesis, and even from overseas. And they want to know, you know, how I achieve this. So I tell my students that the four things can make you a success. Number one, read books. Number two, watch movies. Number three, travel. And number four, mix with people who are better than you are. And I think because I did all of these things, this became my university. So I was introduced to someone by this director from England Here is a guy who spends half his life in darkness. Because I used to see almost every film that came out, and they have not seen this.
Okay. Now, yesterday you were sharing us a very interesting observation that you were telling us. This world is not born to be chaotic, and everything happens for a reason. So I would like to use that as to conclude our interview session today by asking you this. So with that, you know, at the current situation, where do you think our Malaysian movie and film industry is at? You know, where are we now? Are you going to be still very positive about it, or what?
Just like artworks, everything in the world is patterned and organized. That means nothing happens by accident. And this is the reason why that if you go to India, to certain places, there are these palm leaves which were written about 1,000 years ago. So I had heard about this. So on one of my visits, I asked my driver, do you know such a place? And of course, he knew. I could not believe what I was hearing. All they took was my thumbprint. And based on the thumbprint, they looked and took out and described things year by year that actually had happened.
Yeah.
And said, in the next 6 months, you and your son must be careful driving your car. And my son just had an accident with my Volvo. Somebody hit him, he nearly went into the river. And then he said, you drive a white car. I have two white cars. And you have three children, two boys and one girl. How do they know all this? And then he mentioned a lot of other things. And then I said, enough. I don't want to know anymore. Because he came to a point where he talked about something that transcended everything.
Yeah.
So, the seal of a particular country describes that hidden aspects of that country and what it is and what it can become. Indonesia and Thailand, their national seal is the Garuda. The Garuda was a mythical bird with spiritual powers. And this is the reason why, and because it's an ancient story, this is the reason why Thailand and Indonesia comes up with great stories as compared to Malaysia, where we are still struggling to find our identity. Indonesia and Thailand's firms have their own identity, like India. India, its national seal is that, is it the Asoka or something? So it's very deep and it's in the culture and it has to be from thousands of years. Ours is not. Ours, we have Malays, Indians and Chinese were all immigrants. And these were people from the working class. They came to look for food and to survive. Philosophers do not leave their countries. Therefore, we had the worst of the people coming to populate this country. And that's why we are in deep tooth. So our thinking is not very far ahead. We did not go very deep into our subject, except for these few people who have been trained in the West, where they have been trained to be analytical, to be critical in their thinking. So these are the people that, you know, we can pin our hopes on. But as I mentioned in the Malaysian Cinema in a Bottle in my book, in the first chapter, and also in my animation book, that the secret to becoming great storytellers is to go back into our traditional performing arts. Now, I had written this book in 2013. Last year, I was invited by the Japan Foundation under their Cultural Leaders Program to go to Japan for 2 weeks. So I was given business class, 5-star hotel, and met all the top people, and I was treated like a celebrity. And then I went to see my favorite director of all time, Yoji Yamada, who at the age of 83 was going to make his next film. So I sat with him, and he said, when he was young, he met a very famous Portuguese filmmaker called Manuel Oliveira, who died at the age of 102. And Oliveira asked him, what is this one weapon that we have that we can use to fight Hollywood? That means to be on par with Hollywood, which has conquered the whole world. And Yamada said he didn't know. And Oliveira told him, it's the traditional performing arts. And I told Yamada, I'm so happy to hear that because that's exactly what I said in my book. So great minds think alike. Or simple minds seldom differ. So he said, next week I'm shooting my next film. Please come. And of course, I dropped everything else. I sat right behind him, watching him direct a movie. He was so subtle. So he too goes into his traditional performing art, his culture, Zen, and so on. And you can see it in his films. If you ask me to choose any film in the world, above every other film, I will choose his films. Because he's so different. He is funny, he is tragic, you will have tears in your eyes after you see the movie, because the characters are so alive. And those characters do not exist in Japanese life. A very famous character called Tora-san. Now, in Malay culture, we have all these ancient legends like Ikayat Awang Sulung Merah Muda, Ikayat Moro Mahawangsa, and so on. But this is not being taught in primary school, in secondary school. Now, we have to go back to all this because these were teaching films. Because there's hidden inside, you know, all these message. Moral messages. Yeah. This is what I did for my Sangkan Cildan Monyet, where it was subtly brought out. And I analyzed this in my animation book, how the visuals were actually telling stories. For instance, after the monyet has eaten the chili, which he was not supposed to eat, he runs all over the trees and runs away, and he leaps onto two trees which were like this. What does that mean? It means X, you are wrong, visually. And when Sangkanchil and the Kura-Kura stand in the forest, there's a light coming from the from above falling on them. It's a signifier of them being either spiritual or being moral. This is how you must tell stories, using the visuals as well as through dialogue. But mostly visuals, and when the visuals cannot speak to you, you must use words. That's when you start to use words. Now, I'm happy that many of my students and lecturers, I also did training the trainers program for Malaysia as well as Singapore. And this is what I spoke about. And it's going to spread. So it may take time, but at least the spark has been lit. In the West, there is no book that actually tells you about all of these things. So probably my fourth book might be about this. Okay. And I mentioned some of it in my animation book.
Okay. Thank you, Pak Hassan. On behalf of Sharpened, we really, really appreciate your time and sharing with us your vast knowledge.
Yeah, it was a pleasure, CP.
And we'll be looking forward to your afternoon session. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.